All right, so good morning, everybody. My name is Jesse, and if you're joining us for the first time, we are all about bringing conservation, adventure, and science into classrooms around the world. Now, the month of May is our Biodiversity Epic Month. We've got our Backyard Bio Global Nature campaign going on, where we're getting you guys out in your backyards, exploring local wildlife, and sharing it with one another around the world. We've got our Global Biodiversity Festival coming up the third weekend of the month, which is going to be over 150 programs in 3 days, the largest conservation festival ever, with conservationists from every single continent, over 90 countries that we're broadcasting from. So that's pretty epic. And if you want to learn more and register, it's at globalbiofest.com. And all month long, we are featuring epic biodiverse leaders. And today, with this program, we're throwing all that out the window. We're doing something completely different, one of our most unique broadcasts of the month. And we are joined by John Donahue at the Institute for Quantum Computing at the University of Waterloo. This is one of the elite research facilities in the world. I know we've got a lot of Canadians today, Southern Ontarians, and really, if you want to go into engineering, the University of Waterloo is the place. Some of the most amazing stuff happens there. Some of the most amazing people get their start there. And today, we're going to illuminate the science of light. We're going to learn about rainbows and optics and all sorts of things with some cool experiments live on camera. I can't wait. I hope you guys are as excited as I am. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to John to take us away. So, John, thank you so much for joining us, man. And
oh,
take us away.
My pleasure. It's my pleasure to be here. All right. Hi, everyone. My name's John Donahue. I'm the Scientific Outreach Manager at the Institute for Quantum Computing. As Jesse mentioned, we're a research institute at the University of Waterloo, where we kind of study how we can take the science of things like light and think about things on the quantum scale. That's like the sub-microscopic level, the realm of like atoms and molecules and electrons and photons, and think about how we can use those to build new kinds of technologies. So we're going to talk a little bit about that at the end, but what I really want to focus on today is light. This weekend, on May 16th, we have the International Day of Light. So this is a day celebrated around the world where we think about light and all the technologies we have based on light. And, you know, there'll be a lot of different events. If you want to check out the International Day of Light website, they have a bunch of different listings, including this event here. And it's a good time to just, you know, think about how all the different ways that we use light. So I'm just going to bring up my screen. Here we go. So as mentioned, that's May 16th. So who am I? My name's John. I study laser physics. So what I really am interested in is how we use lasers and how we use light to understand the world around us. That's what I like to tell everyone. That's what I'm interested in. But what I'm really interested in is taking big, scary lasers and shooting them around little tables. So I study physics. And what I did during my research was I would basically get a giant Lego kit full of lasers, full of mirrors and lenses and crystals and fun stuff like that, and try to bounce them into different ways and put detectors in just the right places to observe these really small quantum effects, these very, you know, effects that are impossible to see with the naked eye, but just reveal so much about light and reveal so much about the universe around us, all on these kind of tabletop experiments. So if you like playing with Lego and you like playing and you like the idea of playing with lasers, physics is a good place to be. Before I kind of dive into what we're talking about, I want to take a moment of reflection. So light is something that we interact with, you know, for sure every day, both in ways that are kind of obvious. Light is what helps us see, and ways that are maybe less obvious. So you're viewing this over the internet, and a lot of internet signals are delivered via fiber optic cable, which means that light is communicating that information in cables underneath the ground. So, but what exactly is light? Just what is light? So if you're able to comment, feel free to comment. If you just want to take a second and think about, what are the first few words that come to mind when you think about what is light? Let's kind of just think about that for just a second. Okay, everyone hopefully has a couple words in their mind about what they think that light is. I see Jeff is already saying in the comments that light is energy, light is bright. There's a lot of different things that you can come up with there. So one of the first things that came up in the chat, and one of the first things that many people think of, is that light does carry energy. And this is something that we should be pretty familiar with if you've ever gotten a sunburn. The energy from the sun has a lot of ultraviolet light in it, and that ultraviolet light carries its energy onto our skin and irritates our skin by kind of depositing that energy as heat, which causes our skin to sometimes burn if we're overexposed to it. So light does carry energy. But how exactly does it carry it? Like, if we think about, for example, sound carrying energy, we know how sound carries energy. It carries it in the form of, you know, vibrations in the air. But how does light carry energy? So maybe light carries energy in the same way as sound. Maybe light carries energy like a wave. Okay, that's a possibility. So if we wanted to test that possibility, if we wanted to approach that possibility like a physicist, we would need to test whether or not light behaves like a wave. So what are some things that waves do? Waves, they spread out. If we drop a rock in a pond, like we see in this picture here, that creates a wave, which then spreads out away from where we dropped the rock. If we take two rocks and drop them into the pond at the same time, we'll see that the waves will spread out into each other. Now then, when two waves meet each other, something special happens. So we see some regions where the waves meet each other, and they're both going up and down at the same time. When one is up, the other is also up. When one is down, the other is also down. This forms what we call constructive interference. It means that the wave gets even bigger. Okay? The two waves meet each other and make an even bigger wave. But if the two waves are, you know, out of sync with each other, if when one's tall, the other's short, they're going to cancel each other out and cause what we call destructive interference. See, we see here there's almost no wave left, even though we started off with a big wave, because the two waves canceled each other out. So if we can see this with water, can we see this with light? Can we prove that light is a wave by seeing constructive and destructive interference? And that's the idea of the double slit experiment. So in this experiment, we're going to take a flashlight, we're going to take a laser beam in our case, and we're going to shine it through two narrow openings. Now then, when light hits a small, small opening, it spreads out. And if we have two small openings, light from each of those could spread out into each other. If light's a wave, maybe we'll see some kind of interference. Okay, so I'm gonna pull out my camera here, just to let you know. Hi, everyone. So that's the experiment we actually have right here. So we have a laser pointer, as you can see right here. And on this card, which I have another version of right here, we have some very, very small openings that the light can pass through. Okay, this one, you can't really see it on the camera, but it actually has two very small openings right next to each other. And that's what we're going to use to see if the light, if light coming from one opening interferes with the light from the other opening. And so we're going to let that kind of go along here. And we're going to see the pattern on a faraway wall. So let me see if that shows up on the camera. Okay, we see a pattern that looks like this. Now then, because our camera gets saturated, you can't really see, you just see a big bright light, but I'm going to put a filter in front of it to reduce the light intensity. And that reveals some wave structure there. Do you see that there's regions where the light is very, very bright, those very, very bright spots there? But there's also regions where the light cancels itself out. We see those dark bands, those dark fringes, those dark lines inside the bright spot. And that's destructive interference. So we're seeing in this experiment, just like water waves, light waves can interfere with each other and give us constructive and destructive interference. Okay. So if you weren't able to see too well on the camera, this is a more professional photograph of the same effect. This is laser beam interference after this double slit experiment where we see regions of constructive and destructive interference. So light behaves like a wave. But what's actually waving? So light is what we call an electromagnetic wave. Things that carry electricity, things like electrons, those little charged particles in the atom, can actually absorb the light's energy because of this. This is actually why we get things like sunburns, is because the electrons in our body are absorbing the light energy in the form of an electric field. So what this basically means is that light carries an electric field and it waves in a direction 90 degrees to where the light is actually going. So if I'm a beam of light and I'm traveling this way, I might have an electric field that's going up and down like this. So if you think about me staring at you, the electric field would be going up and down. The direction that it waves is called the polarization. So if the beam of light is traveling towards you, it could be the wave could be going up and down like this, or side to side like this. And we call that direction the polarization. We also have these fun little tools called polarizers. And what those do is they absorb light depending on its polarization. So for example, if I have a polarizer, think about it like a little fence that only lets light through if it's waving in the right direction. If the light is going up and down, if the light wave is going up and down like that, a polarizer held like this will allow it to pass through. But a polarizer held horizontally doesn't let the wave get through the fence. So we use polarization actually in many different technologies. So for example, there in photography, people often use polarized filters. These help reduce glare. This is also used in sunglasses. If we want to reduce road glare, we'll wear polarized sunglasses because the light that comes off of the road is actually polarized in a very specific direction. By wearing sunglasses with polarizing filters on them, we can make sure that we can get rid of that road glare while still seeing everything around us clearly. It's also used in 3D movies. The idea of a 3D movie is that you want to make sure that your eyes each see a different image. And by putting a different polarizing filter on each of the lenses, you can project two different images, each with a different electric field orientation, and your eye will only see one of the two based on the glasses. You can use it in materials analysis. It's also used in LCD screens. So if you do happen to have either an old pair of 3D movie glasses or a pair of polarizing sunglasses, try looking at your laptop. You'll be able to see that as you rotate your head, the screen will get dimmer and brighter depending on the angle you hold your head. And this is because LCD screens emit polarized light and sunglasses and 3D movie glasses absorb light depending on its polarization. Okay, let's actually try to see this in action, though. So like I said, you can use your LCD screen and your sunglasses to do this exact experiment. However, just to show it off a bit more, I'm going to use something a little different. I have this giant, fancy-looking plate right here, which is emitting light. Okay, this light, though, has a special property called polarization. So all the electric field components coming out of this beam of light are all traveling in this direction. Most of the light around us is polarized in a random direction. So some of the light might be going back and forth like this. Some of it might be going up and down like this. All the light coming from this screen is going up and down like this. If I take my polarizing filter and place it in front, we see that depending on the angle, I can either block the light or let it through. Okay, so it's very dependent on the angle. When they're aligned, basically this polarizer is saying, I'm emitting light this way, and this filter is saying, I'm blocking light that's going this way. When I hold it like this, this polarizer is emitting the light this way, and this polarizer is like the fence letting it through. Now, when I hold something between two cross polarizers, we can sometimes see some interesting effects. So for example, objects, there's a little bit of glare there. Objects can sometimes rotate polarization, and particularly plastic objects. So this right here is just a piece of, you know, acrylic plastic, and it doesn't seem to look like too much there. But when I apply pressure to it, we start seeing some pressure points displayed through the polarizers. When I don't have the polarizers doing the same thing, nothing happens. When I place it between the cross polarizers, lost my stand. When I place it between the cross polarizers, I can see those pressure points. Basically, what's happening is as I apply pressure to this material, it's straining the light as well and causing the light to rotate which direction the electric field is in. So when I have an object like this plastic fork, I can actually look at it through the cross polarizers. And by looking at those different colors, I can see where the pressure points in this fork may be. This is how people use this effect for things like analyzing different types of materials. Okay, we see the different colors because each color of light also has a specific polarization, and those rotate by different amounts. There are also certain special crystals. Like, for example, this here is called mica. It's a very, very thin sheet crystal. Okay, so it's a crystal like quartz, like diamond, not nearly as expensive, but nonetheless a crystal. It has some structure, and it is what we call birefringent. That means that light that enters it rotates the direction of its electromagnetic field. So if I place that between two polarizers, we see these very, very striking colorful patterns as the light passes through. And that's, once again, the light going through this polarizer here, this polarized light rotating its polarization, and only the light that has the right polarization at the end of the experiment makes it through this filter here. As I rotate that and rotate that, we can see the colors change. So you might be thinking, where can I get some mica that I can actually do this experiment at home? Mica, something your teacher might be able to get, might be hard for you to get your hands on. But what's easy for you to get your hands on is good old Scotch tape. So we can see, just like the fork, there's some colors coming through that Scotch tape container right there. But more interestingly, the tape itself is also birefringent. We see that I put that one layer of tape there, all of a sudden I can see through the polarizer, and that's because the tape itself rotates polarization. If I put more and more pieces of tape on there, I can change the direction of that rotation. And if I do that just a bunch of different times, say for example, I take this old CD case, cover it with tape, I'll be able to eventually get this nice colorful pattern showing up. And that's just by overlapping many, many pieces of transparent Scotch tape onto this CD cover and looking at it between crossed polarizers. So as I mentioned, you can do this at home. You're not going to be able to get your hands necessarily on this fun little tablet that I have, but your LCD screen acts as a source of polarized light. So kind of put a white screen on your monitor. Get a pair of polarized sunglasses, get yourself a Ziploc bag or an old CD case or an old photo case and some tape, layer the tape onto the thing and look at it between your LCD monitor and using your sunglasses, and you'll be able to see as you rotate it, the colors will change. And that's all because of light having this property called polarization. Okay, let's look at that one more time. Now then, we were just doing that with, what I had handy. But if you're a professional, if you're an artist, you can get some really interesting effects that come out here. So for example, here's one by an artist on YouTube called polarizedlightart.cat. And if we let that play, we see that it doesn't look like much, but then when they bring in the polarizer, it shows these wonderful colors coming out of this piece of art. So this is them rotating a polarizer between their camera and their piece of art and showing the colors that are hidden there between the, inside the tape, inside that polarization. Similarly, there is this piece of art done by Dino Tomic, and he's going to show us something really neat. So he's very, very carefully layering on that tape to make something very, very particular in this case. And he's doing it on top of this vinyl piece, puts it on his polarized light source, similar to what we had there earlier, and then looking at it through a polarizer, and what we see, so that's that polarizer film there, basically sunglass film, and he gets this wonderful image of Freddie Mercury, the lead singer of Queen. And this is all just using tape and light polarization. Okay, so what else do we know about light? We know that light has color, and that color is connected to what we've seen before. So we saw in the polarization case that different polarizations rotate by, sorry, different colors rotate their polarization by different amounts inside the plastics. So when we have something like white light, that light that I showed you earlier looked very much white. When we have white light, that's actually made up of many, many, many different colors. So I can take white light and I can think about that as a mixture of blue light, green light, and red light. Perhaps famously, you might have seen the prism experiment before, where we take a beam of white light, shine it through a prism, and each color is going to what we call refract. It's basically going to bend by a different amount, such that the red, the orange, the yellow, the green, the blue, and the purple, all the different colors of the rainbow are going to be split by a different amount. Now then, the color of light is very much related to the wave nature of light. In fact, the wavelength of light, kind of how quickly that wave oscillates up and down, what the repeating wave pattern cycle is like, and what the energy of the light beam is very much related to its color. Let's bring up the camera one more time. Okay. Hello again. So what I have here, this is very similar to the prism experiment. This is what's called the diffraction grating. Okay. So think about it like a piece of material with a bunch of tiny microscopic lines in it. And similar to the prism, which is going to bend light in different amounts depending on its color, this diffraction grating is also going to divert the light by a different amount depending on its color. So I have the exact same thing, but I've kind of taped it up in such a way that only a small amount of light gets through. And I'm going to take my nice bright white flashlight and shine it through there. So we're going to look at what happens on the piece of paper over here. Just readjust the camera real quick. So we see our bright, nice white spotlight here. It looks like white light. If you were to ask what color this is, you would say white light. But when I kind of try to unfold the white light and understand what colors the white light is actually made up of, I'm going to put it through my diffraction grating like this. And we see that rainbow effect. So some of the light doesn't really get diffracted at all, doesn't get bent. But the first bit that does get bent, we can see that rainbow pattern. We see that blue, we see that green, we see that red especially. Those three colors in particular, you can see a little bit of yellow there and well. Those are a little bit of yellow there as well. Those colors are being used together to make up the white light. So white light, when people say that white is not a color in light, that's sometimes what they mean there. White is not one particular color, but rather a combination of all these different colors. So just like you can mix paints together to get different colors, you can mix colors of light together to get different colors as well. In this case, we're mixing blue, green, and red to get a nice bright white light. Now then, there's many, many more colors of light. So those are some of the colors that we can see with our eyes. But there's many colors of light that we can't see with our eyes at all. So this is what we call the extended rainbow, or the electromagnetic spectrum of light. This region right here is what we call the visible spectrum. That expands to get your reds, your oranges, your yellows, your greens, your cyans, your blues, your purples. And that all fits into this one little area right here. This is on what we call a logarithmic scale. So it's actually an even smaller slice than it looks like. But if we look at all these other regimes, we look at X-rays, gamma rays, ultraviolet rays, infrared rays, microwaves, radio waves, TV waves, and what we call long waves. These are all things that we can't see with our eyes, but are used for other kinds of technologies. For example, the fiber-based internet, that uses infrared light, just slightly more red than what our eyes can see. Radar uses microwaves as well as microwave ovens. Your cell phone signals are kind of between microwaves and radio waves. Things like MRI machines that you use to image your body, they use radio frequencies as well. X-ray images on the more energetic side, we use X-rays for building up X-ray images, as well as for understanding crystal structures. And then if we're interested in astrophysics, if we're interested in, you know, the physics of space, we'll often understand that through things like measuring gamma ray emissions, so incredibly high energy light from around the universe. Okay. So light is more than just a wave, though. We've talked about light as a wave. We've understood that light is an electromagnetic wave that has properties like color and like polarization. But what quantum physics tells us is that light is also made up of indivisible particles called photons. So even though light is a wave, light is only emitted in these little tiny chunks. So for example, I can either have zero chunks of light, one chunk of light, two chunks of light, three chunks of light, but I can never have half of a chunk of light or let's say, 1.7 chunks of light. It's always integer numbers, always things that I can count like I would count fingers or marbles. We call each of these chunks a photon. Okay, and we don't normally, you might be thinking, okay, but I see things like dimmer switches in my house. It seems like I can turn light from all the way on to all the way off and anywhere in between. Each photon carries something like a billionth of a millionth of a joule. So, if I were to turn on a light bulb, I'd be emitting something like a million trillion photons per second. So it's not something our eyes are normally sensitive to. But if we design our experiments very carefully, we can see these effects. So for example, this right here is an image from an experiment done at IQC where we did the double slit experiment, that first experiment we saw today where we saw that light behaved like a wave and gave us constructive and destructive interference. We did that experiment, but one photon at a time. So each of these dots corresponds to measuring one photon, one particle, one chunk of light. And while each chunk shows up one at a time, we still see those regions of constructive and destructive interference. Eventually, if we let that pattern build up long and long enough. This is what we call in quantum mechanics wave-particle duality. So light behaves like a wave and light behaves like a particle. And depending on how we look at it, depending on how we measure it, depending on what experiment we do, we can either see the particle effects where we see one at a time or the wave effects where we see these interference patterns. So things like waves and particles, we have to think about them much more in a different way on the quantum scale. And this kind of goes both ways as well. So I have one other quick experiment to show off. All right. Hello again, everyone. So this right here is what we call an electron diffraction tube. So this is a talk about light, but just as light can sometimes behave like a particle and sometimes behave like a wave, there are other quantum objects that also sometimes behave like waves and sometimes behave like particles. So electrons, those are the smallest possible units of charge. We sometimes think about them like little balls that orbit atoms, and they each carry one unit of negative charge. They're the smallest unit of electricity that we have. We usually think about them like particles, but if we do experiments right, we can see things like wave interference there as well. So in this experiment here, we have a tube, and what we have is a hot filament, and that's going to shoot electrons out. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn up a high voltage source, and that is going to speed up those electrons and cause them to hit this screen. When they hit that screen, it's going to glow green. So we're going to start turning that up, and we see that green glow coming up. That's electrons being shot from the back here all the way to the front and making this pattern here. So I'm going to keep turning that up as the electrons get faster and faster and faster. It can't see anything because it's saturating the camera. But if I put this filter in front and bring the camera a little closer, you might be able to see some rings. Yeah? It's a little hard to see on the camera. If you Google electron diffraction, you might be able to get a slightly better photo. But those rings are rings of constructive and destructive interference. And we're seeing that happening with electrons. Do you need me to prove to you that it's electrons? Well, photons, light doesn't respond to a magnet, but electrons, if I move the magnet close to it, I can move those electrons around. Okay, let's turn that off before I burn it out. Okay, so what else can we do with light? So we can use light to send information. As we kind of talked about a bit, light has light can consist of many different colors. Say that I encode information in terms of what color of light I send you. So for example, if I want to send, you know, zeros and ones over the internet, I might say, if you measure a blue photon, that's a zero. If you measure a red photon, that's a one. And I can use that to communicate ones and zeros. And that's more or less how we send information over the internet using optical fiber. So optical fiber is like a little tube that we use to send light. Light gets trapped inside the tube and makes it from one end to the other. Actually, I have a little optical fiber right here. Ooh, sorry, gotta find my camera again. I've lost it. There we go. So I have this little tube right here, and this right here is what we call an optical fiber. I have a laser on the other end there, and as I move the optical fiber around, I'm able to keep that laser light maintained in that fiber. So we see the laser light right there. I'm going to use it to burn out my camera a little bit. And basically, the internet is made up of, you know, many, I'm not even going to guess at how many, a lot of these tubes that carry light and send signals through the light being carried in these optical fibers. We can manipulate the photons and manipulate light to perform many different kinds of tasks that process that information. What we're really interested in here at IQC is how we use it to do things on the quantum scale, things like building quantum computers that process information using things like interference to gain computational advantages and do new kind and perform new kinds of algorithms. There's also groups working at IQC on secure quantum communications where they're actually sending individual photons into space and having them caught by a satellite orbiting the Earth. And you might have heard a bit about the gravitational wave observatories that are all around the world right now. And they're using light in different ways to measure, you know, large black hole level events happening many light years away from us. So these are all things that use very, very faint amounts of light, very, you know, the photon level of light. Meanwhile, there's other people working on building high-powered laser sources. So we're looking at, you know, making incredibly bright sources of light for things like laser cutting, to understand more about nuclear physics, to do things like nonlinear optics, where we can mix different beams of light together to create laser light at new colors and at new wavelengths, and also do things like laser cooling. So you can actually use the energy of a laser to take away energy from atoms and use that to create these kind of clusters of atoms in between magnetic fields. Really neat stuff that happens there, and actually part of along with nonlinear optics, what won the Nobel Prize a couple years ago. Okay, so that's a lot of stuff we talked about today about light. What have we learned? We've learned that light is an electromagnetic wave, and it carries that electromagnetic field with a polarization. Light has a color, and the color of light depends on its wavelength and its energy. So white light, for example, is made up of many, many, many different colors and many, many, many different wavelengths. We've also learned that light is emitted in chunks that we call photons, and that light and lasers are important for many different kinds of technologies. And with that, I'm more than happy to open to questions. You can find us online at IQC.ca. You can find more stuff about the International Day of Light at www.lightday.org. And yeah, I'd like to thank you for your attention this afternoon. This has been a lot of fun.
Thank you so much, John. That was fantastic, man. Seriously, if we had more people in the YouTube chat, I'd just be like, wow, like the equivalent of like they're just jaws on the floor, not knowing what's going on. It's so cool. This is awesome. If you want to come out of screen share and just see us, have a bit of a conversation, you're welcome.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Take your time with that. We've got more questions than we can possibly answer anyone right now. Over 400 kids tuning in from across the continent, so welcome in and beyond, actually. We've got a class in Portugal today, which is really exciting. But we're going to start by going to Mr. Shatter's class. They're joining us in Chalk River, Ontario. If you guys want to kick us off with any questions, I'm sure there are many. Go for it, guys.
Sure. Thanks, John, for the presentation. We're so close to May the 4th here that I feel I have to ask a Star Wars question for some of my students. Is there any way that we can take light and stop its movement after it has started that could make lightsabers possible?
Ooh, I like that question. So making lightsabers possible, you need a few different things to work. Like, you know, think about the lightsaber. If you wanted to make it work exactly as it seems to work in the Star Wars universe, you need kind of the beam of light to go and then after a certain point, stop. There are experiments that you can actually do using what we call slow light, where you can slow light down. And by, you know, and that's basically where the light interacts with a cloud of atoms. And inside that cloud of atoms is really slowed down. And if you go to a certain extent, you can reflect it back for sure. The harder part for a lightsaber is that, well, we need a lightsaber battle. We need to have two lightsabers that come together. And when one hits the other, they, you know, reflect, they deflect each other. As we can, you know, only have one flashlight on me right now at the moment, but if I take two flashlights and kind of start doing this to each other, they just pass right through each other. Light does not like to interact with light. We can, however, see some of these effects in special kinds of materials, what we call nonlinear materials. In these materials, we can have light talk to other beams of light. And what can happen sometimes is two beams of light can merge together. And, you know, one beam of light can control the other beam of light. They can merge together into one beam of light at a higher frequency. There's a lot of neat experiments, some with quantum information tie-in, some with telecommunications tie-in, but some that are just, you know, looking for the right medium to build a lightsaber. And it's something people are working on for sure.
Hello, John. that is a delightfully nerdy question and answer. So thank you very much for that. I don't know. It seemed to have perfected it while we've been doing this broadcast. But I'll leave it for now. Let's head to Ms. Holden's class. Join us in Spruce Grove, Alberta. Come on in, guys, and take us away.
Oh, it's pretty hard to beat the May the 4th questions and lightsabers, but we've been doing some light experiments looking at reflection of light and noticing Lily and Leighton have noticed that when we reflect light in mirrors that it tends to get dimmer quite quickly. Is there a way to keep it bright?
So when you reflect light off a mirror, it gets dimmer, and that's going to depend on the properties of the mirror more than anything else. So we like to think about mirrors as these perfect objects that reflect light, but any object is going to some percentage reflect light, to some percentage absorb light, to some percentage let light pass through. So to make that better, it might be as simple as getting a brighter mirror. It might be as simple as a more reflective mirror. Anything, even if you have a mirror that's 95% reflection, if you stack 10 of them in a row, eventually you're going to lose a lot of light. This is not really a problem for a lot of technologies because we can just amplify the image. Think about like running your camera for longer, or in telecommunications, we literally boost the signal. For the people like me who work on like single photon stuff, where once you lose a photon, it's gone forever, we really worry about making sure we have these perfectly reflective mirrors.
It's funny, we've been getting a lot of mirror questions in the chat, so I'm really glad we got that one. So thanks, Ms. Holden. All right, we're going to head all the way to Portugal, to Valongo, Ms. Enriquez's class. If you guys have a question for us, come on in. It's such a treat to have a class on the other side of the pond.
Hi. I have a student here who is going to ask a question, okay?
Absolutely.
My question, how can you use lasers to cool other materials?
Ooh, how do you use lasers to cool other materials? Really good question, and not obvious at all. Like I said, people who discovered this did win a Nobel Prize for it. It is very, very important and not at all how we think about things. So we use lasers to cool. Let's think about what temperature is first. So temperature is a measure of how much activity, how much excitement there is in a material. So if I think about a material as made up of many molecules and atoms, if those molecules and atoms are moving around and, you know, really have a lot of kinetic energy, you know, have a lot of motion, we say that it's a very hot material and we feel it as a hot material. If the atoms and molecules in the material are moving around slowly or perhaps not moving much at all, we think about that as a cold material. Temperature measures molecular and atomic activity. Okay, so how do we use the lasers to actually cool down a material? We do that not by, you know, we can easily heat a material with a laser by just blasting it with energy and giving that energy to the atoms and molecules. To cool it down, we need to be a bit more delicate. What we do is we use the laser to control the molecules and atoms in the material. Basically, a laser can talk to an atom and molecule. If we don't control it well, it'll just give it energy and cause it to go haywire. But if we are very delicate, we can almost perform, we can almost program a set of instructions for the molecules that tell them, be here, calm down, go here, calm down, go here. And by structuring it in that way, by telling all the molecules and atoms where to go, we can reduce their activity and cool things down. In fact, in certain like very, very small regions of material, scientists have used lasers to cool down to the nanokelvin scale. So that's about 1/1,000,000,000th of a degree above absolute zero. So effectively control all the atoms in such a way that they're very chill, let's say.
John, you are smarter than I will ever be. That was very, very cool. I'm so glad we got that question, actually. The moment you brought that up in the broadcast, it was something I was going to share. So thank you for our student in Milongo. That was awesome, guys. I'm going to go to Mr. Krar and Mr. Bocci in just a minute, but I want to take some questions from YouTube because there are just so many, and I'm sorry, we just can't get to them all today. But Silas in Mr. Hancock's class in Georgetown, Ontario, he's been asking a ton of questions. He wants to know, how long would you have to look at the sun before it caused damage to your eyes?
I definitely don't have a number of seconds or anything like that that I can share. It's going to depend on how bright of a day it is. I'd be careful though, because it's not just like staring at the sun until your eyes start hurting. Your eyes will start hurting and your blink reflex will kick in. Your eyes will force themselves to blink because of things like the light that you can see. But there's a lot of light coming from the sun that you can't see, a lot of infrared and especially ultraviolet light, you know, light that's bluer than what your eye can see. And that's what causes the damage. That's why you're not supposed to look at the sun during an eclipse. It's not because of the light that you can see. That's fine. That's not going to hurt you. It's the light that you can't see that would normally cause your eye, that would normally be shut off when your eyes blink due to the visible light. Because of that extra light, that's what hurts your eyes. I don't know how long it would take for your eyes to actually be damaged by staring directly at the sun, but it can happen pretty quickly. During an eclipse, it can happen pretty quickly. So my guess is it happens pretty quickly without an eclipse either.
I think the moral of the story here is don't look directly
at the sun. Don't look at the sun.
It's best to avoid that, but I love the question. Let's go to Ms. Sola's class. You're actually talking about light we can't see, and there's a great segue here with her question, which is, what if we could see more colors than we could actually see, like the extended rainbow?
Yeah, if we can see them, then we can use them for different tasks. And a lot of tools that we do use are basically to let us see in those wavelengths, to see that extended rainbow. So you might have seen like night vision cameras and like thermal imaging cameras, you know, where you kind of see people through walls almost. And that's by looking at the infrared spectrum. So light that's less energetic than our eyes can see, more red than red. If we could see that, we could, you know, see sometimes through walls or be able to get a better idea of what temperature objects are glowing. If we go in the opposite direction, if we are able to see in the ultraviolet spectrum, actually don't know what that gives us. Not sure if that gives us too much, but people build ultraviolet cameras and x-ray cameras for many different kinds of technologies. Microwave imaging is often used in radar, so we need to build something that can see in the microwave regime. And when we say visible light, we always mean visible to humans. Other animals can see different colors, and that helps them in different ways as well. So visible is relative to the human eye is an important thing there.
I'm so glad you brought that up. And a really neat, unexpected tie into our program literally last hour with wildflowers. Most flowers will have a different colored center to them. You'll notice this in your gardens. And that different colored center actually glows quite brightly to a lot of insects that see it in the ultraviolet. So a lot of insects will see in different wavelengths than we see. It allows them to see that much more like a beacon or a bullseye, which is very cool. let's go to Mr. Krar's class. Joining us in Calgary. If you want to unmute your microphone, come on in. Go for it.
Hi, really enjoyed the presentation. My question is, you know, with regards to global warming, what do you think about the idea? I think it's called geoengineering, where they're going to talking about seeding the high atmosphere with chemicals like silver particles to reflect incoming radiation from the sun. It sounds bonkers to me, but I heard Bill Gates is backing this project. What's your opinion?
I am not an expert in this field, so I am not going to, I do not have a, let's say, an informed opinion on it. That being said, if we're reflecting incoming radiation from the sun, I get the feeling there'll be some other side effects there. We're more worried about other things happening on the planet than solar radiation is for many things, a good thing. We want light for plants and all that kind of thing. That being said, there's other people who are working on this, and it's very much something that people should be looking into, both from a theoretical, like, you know, would this cause harm to the planet? Would this be a net good for the planet? And from an experimental, like, if we wanted to do it, is it even possible kind of perspective? Yeah,
that's a great answer. No, this is a really complicated issue. I know it's outside of your basic realm of expertise. It's something that we've actually covered in a few broadcasts in the past. Okay. It's a really complicated story. And it's something where, you know, as humankind, you might want to deliberately work to try and undo some of the inadvertent effects that we've done for putting other chemicals and things up in the atmosphere. But it is very complicated. It's not something that's happening anytime soon, Mr. Carr. And I'm really glad we got that question. So thank you for that, guys. Mr. Boccia, coming in Toronto, and I'll take one question from YouTube as I love it to wrap up the broadcast in a minute. So Mr. Boccia in Toronto, go for it.
My class was really interested when you brought up quantum computers. Do you have any idea how far away we might be from quantum computing?
Just threw it right into my wheelhouse. A quantum computer, what we need to build a quantum computer is we're going to need to be able to control a lot of systems that obey quantum mechanics. This could be photons, this could be electron spins, this could be superconducting circuits, atoms and ions. There's a lot of different ways you can think about building it. As for how far we are from actually doing it, it's really hard to say, and it kind of depends on what the goalpost is. So a quantum computer processes information in ways differently than a classical computer. So for certain problems, things like simulating quantum systems and some surprising things like factoring large numbers, a quantum algorithm can beat a classical algorithm. Basically, both computers and quantum computers process information. A quantum computer obeys different rules. Only for specific problems does a quantum computer have an advantage. And the big question is, when are we going to have a quantum computer that gives us an advantage for a practical problem? It's really hard to say. In some sense, we already have quantum computers. We have devices that use quantum systems to process information in different ways, but they tend to be very, very small and very, very noisy. They've already shown that some of these systems can solve problems that regular computers are unable to solve, but it's for very, very specific problems that aren't necessarily useful. They're more like, we designed a problem to show off our quantum computer rather than here's a problem that you might actually want to solve in your everyday life or in a research scenario or something like that. And those results are a little contentious, a little bit. They're generally accepted, but there's a little bit of contention still remaining. That being said, considering where we were 10 years ago, that in itself is a huge, huge, huge step and very, very frankly surprising to a lot of scientists that we've gotten that far that quickly. So when are we going to have something that can, you know, fulfill, you know, do everything that people think quantum computers will be able to do? That's going to be many decades away. When are we going to have a quantum computing device that can solve a problem in a useful way? There's a lot of optimism that we'll have that in, you know, some people will say 10 to 20 years. Some people will be more gung-ho than that. I don't really have a prediction to, except to say that we're already a lot, things are going faster than I expected when I first got into this field. And it's, you know, some really neat stuff that could come out.
Sort of like nuclear fusion or going to Mars or dark matter. It's like, it's always coming. It's so close. We're almost there, we promise.
There's always steps along the way, though. There's always steps along the way.
It's a really neat story to highlight the fact that it has progressed faster than you would have expected. You have the expertise to judge that sort of thing. So I'm really glad we got that question. So thank you, Mr. Boccia. I know we have so many professional questions and deep-seated questions, but what I want to do is, you know, we began the broadcast with Disney intellectual property with Star Wars, and we're going to end it with some Marvel. The gamma rays you mentioned, can those affect particular side effects if someone was exposed to them, John? What can happen with gamma rays?
I mean, they're electromagnetic radiation of high energy, so I get the feeling it could do, you know, you got to be careful. Like if you're in like in an area where you're exposed to gamma rays constantly, you need to be wearing something called a dosimeter that tells you, are you in the safe regime or are you in the unsafe regime? Similar to if you're working in a nuclear reactor. They will not turn you into the Hulk, to the best of my knowledge, but give scientists enough time, they'll find a way to make it work.
Okay, we're gonna hold you to that, and we'll come back in 30, 40 years when we've made that possible. John, this has been so much fun. Honestly, the feedback has been amazing. Thank you so much to our huge international audience, intercontinental audience, which is really exciting. And what I want to do is just bring up two quick things that you mentioned. If you want to learn more about the Institute for Quantum Computing at University of Waterloo, IQC.ca, and John also mentioned the International Day of Light coming up and fast approaching, so check out lightday.org if you want to see more about that. John, I know it's been a while since you joined us for any broadcast, but what I want to do is bring in all our class to say a quick thank you and goodbye. So Mr. Shattuck, Miss Holden, Miss Enriquez, Mr. Crocker, Mr. Bosley, if you want to join me in saying